that he has to identify the God that he's speaking for. He has to pinpoint that I'm talking about, look at everything you see, the God that made all of that, that's who I'm speaking for. Now, you had a prophet who was talking for the tree god, the moon god, and everybody else, and people would fall for what he had to say. Mm-hmm. Now, Jeremiah had to say that, I'm look at everything that you see, the God that made that, and he gave the natural order of things. That's who I'm speaking for. And you can believe it or not, sometimes what I say is good to your ear, sometimes what I say is bad to your ear. And if it's bad, and I'm saying God's going to punish you, you can count on it. So that's how God dealt with them. So he's saying here, I got to put my bifocals in this. The maker thereof, verse 2, the Lord that formed it to establish it, the Lord is his name. And he says in verse 3, to do what? Call unto me, and I will do what? And show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not. And people are still missing out on this part of God today. Call upon me, and I'll show you some things that you are not aware of. I will answer you. And so he's telling them that you got to call me, and I'll show you great, mighty things which thou knowest not. And this was the one thing that they did not know was God's character. That's what they're missing out on, is God's character, which now let's take a look at it, how it's revealed to us by Jesus, Luke 15 and 6. We get a different look of it, somewhat of another view. Luke 15:3. He spake this parable unto them, saying, what man of you having 100 sheep, if he lose one of them, do not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after that which is lost until he finds it? That's God's character. And when he had found it, he laid it upon his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he come home, he called together his friends, neighbors, saying unto them, what?
Rejoice.
For I have found my sheep, which was lost. That's God's character today. I think Paul says somewhere, it's God's will that no man should do what? He don't want anybody to perish. But back then, he messed up, break the law, don't want to get it right, he could kill you, and keep right on with it. So you look at him today in the covenant we have, is that not only will he go find that lost sheep, but he'll put him up on his shoulder, and he'll nourish him, and he'll comfort him, and he'll do all the good stuff to him and bring him back. And then he'll rejoice when he's got him and he'll win him back. That's his character today. So he's saying he wants to show people in sin, this is how I am. This is how I am. You don't want to restore me back? You don't want to give me back? This is how I am. All right, praise God. So, someone read verse 4. Someone read verse 4 for us.
For thus saith the Lord, the God of Israel, concerning the houses of this city, and concerning the houses of the kings of Judah, which are thrown down by the mounts and by the sword.
Concerning the houses of this city, and I'm concerning the houses of, thus said the Lord God of Israel, concerning the houses of the kings of Judah, which are what? Thrown down by the mounts. In other words, everything you try is thrown down, destroyed by your enemy. Everything you try. Every time you go to work and get paid, you try to close that hole in your pocket. And it disappears. Everything you try on your own is going down because of disobedience. That's what he's telling them. Then he's mixing good word with bad word, good prophecy with bad prophecy. Verse 5, he comes out saying, they come to fight with the Chaldeans, that is, to fill them with the dead bodies of men. In other words, every time you try and fight the Chaldeans, you come back, everybody is killed. Whom? And then God interjects and tells you who's behind your defeat. Whom I have, what, slain in my anger and in my fury. And for all whose wickedness I have hid my what? Face from the sea. Because of their wickedness, I have hid my face from the sea. Then you just keep on being a loser. Because you go through that cycle. You can't overcome your sin issues. So therefore, you're in bondage to the Chaldeans, which is a type of sin and the devil, the way we see it today. Okay, I'm running real fast because we were running late. Verse 6. So I'm going to read that if you will.
Behold, I will bring it health and cure, and I will cure them and reveal unto them the abundance of peace and food.
He will reveal. In other words, he wants to show himself. Now, I speed it up too fast, and I, verse 3, the word, he said, mighty things calling to me, I will show you great and what kind of things?
Mighty things are things
that the word mighty is translated, things that are inaccessible to you, that you have never seen before. It's been hidden from you. You hadn't seen this before. There's been something that's blocking you from seeing this. Scripture is to show you what he means by keeping you out. Keeping you out of the good stuff. You don't have access to it. Would have been like in Numbers 13 and 23. And then as you look at that, I would say in the New Testament, when you come to Christ, you start getting stuff revealed to you of who you are in Christ. Some people just get saved and they say, Lord, help. Some people get saved and they get revealed as to what is theirs and what are the rights in the New Testament covenant. What can I claim? What can I hold God to? And he said, that's mine, that's my right. As a child of God. In the Old Testament, you blocked out of this. You can't get it. But God would show it to them if they were in his right order. Did anybody ever get that scripture of something that shows that you're walled off? Can you? Right, it's in Numbers 13, 28. You might have it.
Nevertheless, the people be strong that dwell in the land, and the cities are walled and very great. And moreover, we saw the children of Anak.
Yeah, the children are walled, very great. Anak got the land. He can't get to it because those big giant enemies, and they got big giant walls. He can't get to the promised land. So, but now, in the New Testament, you have access. Like I said, Paul says you have access into this grace, Lord, in you stand. You have access to it all. If you got enough faith to get there. Verse 6 of our lesson. Behold, I will bring it what? Health and cure. I will cure them and will reveal unto them the abundance of peace and truth. This is what he's, so this is the good part of his message, is that I will reveal. And most of the time we miss out on, and somebody look at, I think it's Psalms 147 and 3, how he's going to do this. We miss out on just, I'm saved, just got enough insurance to get to heaven. and God doesn't reveal anything else to me because I'm not open for him to reveal what he has. God wants to show us. Bring health, cure them. I will reveal unto them the abundance of what I have. So, what does Psalm 147?
He heals the broken in heart.
Okay.
And bindeth up their wounds.
All right, praise God. So this is his character. This is what he wants to do for those that repent, get out of that cycle of sin. And I will cause the captivity of Judah, in verse 7 now, and the captivity of Israel to return. And will build them at the first rest. So he's promising them. I'm telling you, he says, I'm promising you, I will turn your captivity, and I will build you again. And I will cleanse them from all their what? Oh, man. Whereby they have what? Sinned against who?
Me.
Sinned against me, and I have what? Pardoned all their iniquities, whereby they have sinned, and whereby they have transgressed against me. And I wanted to read from my lesson what those sin issues were. Iniquities speaks of, okay, let me say here. Okay. All right. Our text includes three Hebrew words for sin. Iniquity speaks of twisting or distorting God's standard. Sin means missing the way or falling short of God's standard. Transgression denotes revolting against that standard. So, how many of you are bad like that? Either twisted it, distorted it, completely against it. The word. The Bible says when we were like that in our minds, we gave Jesus Christ. That's the New Testament side of stuff. So at this point, Jerusalem had been anything but a joy, peace, or honor to God. They were not. They embarrassed God. Verse 9 should be to me. Someone read that if you will, please.
And it shall be to me a name of joy, a praise, and an honor before all the nations of the earth, which shall hear all the good that I do unto them, and they shall fear and tremble for all the goodness and for all the prosperity that I procured unto it.
Unto it. Now, let's keep in mind that as these words are being read, as I heard, they sound good, but Jeremiah is in a prison camp as he is saying these words. Now, here's something about the Word of God. It is not what? Bound. And this is what Paul says in 2 Timothy 2 and 9, if you can read that, get there. He says, even though I'm in prison, I can still preach. And so sometimes even though you're in a mess and God's speaking to or through you, you can still speak the Word of God. And this is what Jeremiah, in his bad situation in prison, the anointing is on him. What do you do? Look at my surroundings and just stop preaching your business? Stop saying anything? He said, anyway. See, did anybody get that real quick as I shouted it out? 2 Timothy 2 and 9. Anybody in that neighborhood?
Wherein I suffer trouble as an evildoer, even unto bound, but the word of God is not bound.
But the word of God is not bound. So it wasn't bound by the circumstances of decay and a collapsed community, the economy, and all like that. So he still preached it. They still got to hear that good news and choose to believe it. All right, now here we go. Restoration. How does God want to restoration and restore them? Let me jump to an area of controversy right quick. The church. The church versus the pagan world. Are we distinct enough to what the church, the modern, the Church of Jesus Christ, not the latter day, church. Are we distinct enough from paganism distinctive enough? That's the Church of Jesus Christ. They have no paganism attached to tie similarities or what have you. Because this was the problem of that day, is that Jerusalem, Judah, Israel, adapted the paganism worship system, their belief system, all like that. And they just embarrassed and just messed God up. Dishonored God by doing those kind of things. What about the church today? Is the church distinct from the world of paganism? This is Pearl breezes through. Jesus Church, is it distinguished enough from paganism?
I would say as a whole, no.
Okay.
But there are some exceptions. As a whole, no.
Okay. Anybody else? Matthew 5, 13, 16. Let's see what Jesus had to say. Yeah, this is how you should be distinct. You are the what?
Matthew 5, 13
through 16.
That's what we're reading. Ye are the salt of the earth, but if the salt have lost its savor, wherewith shall it be salted? It is thenceforth good for nothing, but to be cast out, and to be trodden under foot of men. Ye are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, and it giveth light unto all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men, that they may see your good works, and glorify your Father which is in heaven.
All right, praise God. Philippians 2, verse 14 through 15. Are we distinctive enough? Or is it?
Do all to 14, 15?
Uh-huh.
Do all things without murmuring and disputing. Okay, that we may be blameless and harmless, the sons of God, without rebuke, in the midst of a crooked and perverse nation, among whom ye shine as lights in the world.
We just read the new, over here on this side. Oh, how good that light! I shine. I'm different. There's no mistake between me and paganism. Sounds good, but they got carried into captivity because God couldn't tell them. You lost your what? I can't tell my people from you. Whoa. Okay, praise God. Now,
well, that question, yes, earlier.
Enough distinction between paganism and Christianity? I said the church, same thing. Between the church and paganism.
It ought to be, but yeah.
God brought judgment on America today. What did he say? It's night and day between the church and the world.
Not the church as a whole.
So, and then now, well, I want you to understand that this is the second entry into the promised land. And then there is a biblical prophecy, the same prophet, talking about that another restoration, and it is the coming of Christ, which is what Pastor Hill is easing us into. He made me sleep. They're going to be talking about that second coming of Christ setting up his millennium kingdom on the earth. And when he comes back, he's coming back for what kind of a church?
Church without spot or wrinkle or any such thing.
See, they thought they had it made. And he came out and used his prophet and pronounced judgment. I can't tell the difference between you and them. Captivity. And then when Jesus come back, he said, this kingdom, which this same prophet is prophesying in foretold stages and experiences. Now, the last time that Jerusalem was, Judah was thrown down was 70 A.D. And now it's going to be restored again, and we're moving back into that restoration, and then they're coming and look at that. Those ends of those prophecies is talking about Christ coming back, setting up his millennial kingdom. And some, as you're thinking, some folks think they're going to be there.
You know, God has always been a God of love, even then and even now. Mm-hmm. And a warning always comes.
Yes.
Jeremiah,
yeah.
Isaac, all the prophets always warn.
Yeah.
And even now, we're being warned. It says a warning comes before destruction and a haughty spirit before fall.
Yeah.
So he's always had someone that warned us, his people.
Yeah. And sometimes we think we, how are we taking it? Really?
Well,
we really like, buying that preacher. Is
he, you know, for 120 years, nobody listened to him like
this. Yeah.
What is he talking about?
Yeah. Listen to the prophets.
Yeah. Right. It's like, yeah, right.
Here we go. So, anybody ever read the book of Lamentations?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, let's read Lamentations, first chapter, verse 1 through 4.
You got to go ahead at the same time.
And it came to pass in the 13th year, in the 4th month, in the 5th day of the month, as I was among the captives by the river of Chebar, that the heavens were opened, and I saw visions of God. In the 5th day of the month, which was the 5th year of King Jehoiachin's captivity, the word of the Lord came expressly unto Ezekiel the priest, mm-hmm. the son of Buzi, mm-hmm. in the land of the Chaldeans by the river Chebar, mm-hmm. and the hand of the Lord was there upon him. And I looked, and behold, a whirlwind came out of the north, a great cloud and a fire unfolding itself, and a brightness was about it, and out of the midst thereof, as the color of amber, out of the midst of the fire. Also out of the midst thereof came the likeness of four living creatures, and this was their appearance. They had the likeness of a man. How far?
So I just want to stop at verse 4.
Okay.
But this is in that same setting that one of the children of captivity, God is showing, revealing to him future events. And so they may discuss if they're in sin or in a losing state status. God's word is still trying to speak to bring his people out, and he's using back in those times prophets to make those expressions. But and you can see what everything that he said, that what I saw and all of this is happening, gonna be happening. Sometimes prophecy, you can be right in the midst of it, you can hear it. I could be unfolding right in your midst and you're not aware of it. This is why he said that I will reveal to them so that we'll know what's going on. In this New Testament side of things, we have a very big advantage if we are sensitive enough to know that what the times are saying. Remember, Jesus got on them and said, you mean you know everything else, but you don't know these times? Can you... You are of Israel, and you don't know these times?
Oh, boy.
Okay, back to our lesson real quick. Verse 10, thus said the Lord again, y'all should be heard in this place, which you say should be desolate, without man and without beast, even in the cities of Judah and in the streets of Jerusalem, that are desolate, without man, without inhabitant, and without beast. That's how it was just wiped out. Just wiped out. No economy, no commerce, no, just wiped out. The enemy came in and just wiped out the beautiful cities of the Lord. Cities of David. Mm-hmm. Gone. This ain't happening. I don't know. Think that could happen to America? New York City?
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, God.
Everything. The other day they had a baseball game. Now, anybody see it? Derek Jeter's last baseball game. How much does it cost to attend that baseball game? Someone said $18,000
for one person
for a seat.
Oh, that's wild.
Yeah.
Anybody else hear that beside me?
I heard one guy was bidding to get a ticket to go to that game. I forget how much it was, but he was willing to pay anything just to watch that game.
Yeah, he can watch it on TV.
Well, he wanted to be there.
So that's the number one economic city, economy of the world, New York. If you live in New York, I had a friend tell me he was from New York. He said, if you make $50,000 a year, you live out of a dumpster.
Yeah,
there's
nothing in New York.
I do have some trouble to tell you.
Yeah,
well, to do. So, can you see New York? Bam, collapse. You got a piece of the enemy. They tried that 9/11, 9/1 deal. Mm-hmm. Even the enemy comes to the heart of the.
And when I just said that, me and the friend were talking the other day about the price stuff in New York. Back when I was up in 75, we were talking about how hamburgers were. We paid $6 for hamburgers.
Oh, my God. How much? 1975.
75, yeah.
How much are they now?
I don't know.
$14. Who said that?
$14
for a hamburger.
Here in
Tulsa?
No. Oh, okay. All right. Here is a real people, but you get fried everything.
That's not an airport. Okay. You go to the airport anymore.
You want to find investors to invest in your enterprise.
The airport will be like $20.
You find some, throwing some money, venture capital, throwing some money in price. So that falls. This is what Jerusalem was. It was the light of the whole. This is what God wanted it to be. Prosperity and peace and all of that. So, part of the glasses, but my Bible. Okay, verse 11. Someone read that.
The voice of joy and the voice of gladness, the voice of the bridegroom and the voice of the bride, the voice of them that shall say, praise the Lord of hosts, for the Lord is good, for his mercy endureth forever, and of them that shall bring the sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. For I will cause to return the captivity of the land as at the first, said the Lord.
Yeah, man. So here's a thing we hear a lot in this that stands out. It was the voice of that sacrifice of praise. Remember that it's not returned to its status yet, but somebody, even in captivity, has to go into God's presence, and he says, even them that bring that sacrifice of what? Praise. So, what is a sacrifice of praise? And make it shortcut, because I know y'all don't get it wrong.
Well, our lesson say, greatness of God, a thanks offering.
All right, A sacrifice of praise is a confession. Confession of thanks, confession of who God is, a confession of what God says. You might not be experiencing it, but you are. It's a confession. You have to confess it first. And to come out of sin and be saved, you have to do what first? Confess. You should confess with your mouth. Believe in your heart. Believe in your heart. Confess with your mouth. You come out of it. But so we're in a situation where the economy's collapsing, New York's bad, economy, jobs gone, all those foreclosures, repossessions, all this and all that. Somebody got to be able to say with their mouth, this is what the Lord says. Here's my confession. This is what I say. And that's what David was, they got all of this from the Psalms. David showed them how to come out. You got to make the confession. Versus your circumstances. So, all right, praise God. And that's pretty much the lesson in a heartbeat. A person that stays in that cycle of sin, forgiveness, restoration, back in the sin. Nobody went on that. Ask for forgiveness. Can't get it right. Keep on. And never get the victory until they repent and obey God,
or
experience the blessings of the
covenant. Yeah, why is that so hard for people to understand that you have to repent of your sins? You know?
Because men want to do it his way. And that's how they got in trouble here, because they wanted everything that they saw the pay
them
at.
They got a king, we want a king.
They got to wearing their jewelry a certain way. They're wearing tattoos. Maybe they're not wearing either.
Right.
So, you know, we want to be like them. We want our stuff to look like them. And maybe it will keep you as gods. Maybe we won't.
I don't worship you like they worship me.
And that's Moses went up to the mountain. It's a perfect illustration of it. Yeah. Make us a golden calf so we can see our God. We can see him, not just someone who's got the ability. We want to see up in areas like we're worshiping. There we go. I didn't point out anyone already. Pastor Hill showed that at the meeting. I guarantee you.